You and I with Rashmi Shetty is a human library audio podcast, bringing in stories of people you and I can draw inspiration from. Welcome to the third season of this amazing story listening journey. Ordinary folks, extraordinary lives, their uniqueness and individuality, making them interesting to talk to and to listen to. Each one of them completely connected to the voice in me and with motivational stories of moving beyond themselves to make a difference in the world. A reaffirmation of the fact, open your eyes wider. The world is far more beautiful when we acknowledge the presence of both you and I. Our guest today is Vijaya Deepthi, a member board of directors at Tata AIG General Insurance Company Limited. She's the chairperson for the Risk Management Committee and member audit committee at Tata AIG. She's an independent director at Aster DM Healthcare. She was the CEO of Tata Insights and Quants, a division of the Tata Industries Limited. She has been supporting a number of IEEE working groups to build industrial AI standards. She was with TCS for over three decades and played a number of roles both at the corporate and the business unit level. She was on the board of Diligenta, which is a regulated subsidiary of TCS in the UK. She was head of the global insurance product business at TCS. Under Deepthi's leadership, the TCS insurance unit won a number of strategic large deals, acquired new customers, and achieved multifold growth. As a long-standing member of TCS Business Excellence Council, Deepthi has been responsible for driving the Tata Group's Business Excellence Initiative. She has worked as the head quality counsel and has championed the various Six Sigma initiatives within TCS across multiple customer engagements. In December 2009, she was conferred the Leading Business Woman of the Year award by Women Leaders in India. This was in recognition for her contribution towards growing the insurance business within TCS despite the global economic downturn. She has been working with a number of NGOs in areas such as integrated forest management, education for underprivileged, and grooming of leadership talent. Listen in as Deepthi shares her journey, important milestones, and how women can help themselves. Hi, Deepthi. Such a pleasure having you on You and I with Rashmi Shetty. Welcome. I have always seen you as somebody who's very happy, giggly, but then at the same time, when a question is put forth to you, you come across as somebody who is very measured when you talk and the information that you give, you're very brief in your answers, but they're loaded answers. I'm very curious to know what little Deepthi was like to the Deepthi Vijayan that the world knows you today as.
You know, that's a very good question to ask me, because when my family sees me now, they say, are you the same Deepthi that we knew when you were young, actually? So, and when I was young, I was one of those who had a very strong sense of justice, actually. And you know, I was a very protective sister. So both my elder brother and my younger brother, you know, would vouch for it, actually, saying that if there was any injustice, Deepthi is there to protect them. And as interesting for me was also that sense of fairness was something which was always there. And I had a lot of conversations with my mother, actually, when we were young. And she would talk of her experiences. Her grandfather was was part of the, I think, heading the police force, you know, for the Andhra, this thing. And then one of her uncles was the head of ASI, Architectural Society of India. And I mean, so the type of conversations that you would have is more of India. You know, what did we go through? Then she had the experience of listening to Sarojini Naidu. So when we learned, the poetry of Sarojini Naidu in our schools, it was something which I think I have really, great memories of, and then she would tell me that, you have to read a few books. So Leo Tolstoy's Anna Karenina, you have to read Dostoevsky, you have to read these. So then, she would be, very fond of the Omar Khayyam and all. So she had Urdu and Telugu and, the Sanskrit mix in her life, in her studies, I guess, and in her life. So we had all these other experiences. So that was one side of our story. And the other side was my father was a scientist, actually. So he would talk of fundamental particles physics. He would be very keen to share the research that he was doing and so on. So, and I would be the person that, he would say, okay, come, Deepti, I'll tell you what I've been doing. I mean, it used to be very, very long, monologues that I would hear from him, and possibly a lot of it would go over my head. But, there was a lot of things that, I would, really look up to. One was I was very fond of, the math, in my life, actually. So I was always good at math. I was fascinated with the periodic table and the evolution of metals and materials and all that. And for me, my role model from a life perspective was Marie Curie, actually. So she was one of those first women, to get a Nobel Prize in both physics and chemistry. And so for me, that was Sarojini Naidu on one side and Marie Curie on the other side. So you can understand the contrast and the dynamics and so on. But I think, I mean, that is something which gave us a lot of food for thought, actually. And I was also such a voracious reader that a piece of paper, even if it came wrapped up, for a vegetable and all that, I would read. So I would read in any language, actually, Hindi, English, Telugu, whatever language we would get at home, and I would read those and so on. But that was, my mother would subscribe to Bhavan's journal, so I would sit down, read, the Bhavan's journals, then look at the Sanskrit and the English translation. So I would learn shlokas, only after I understood their meaning. But let me rephrase that, after I read the meaning. So I don't know whether I'll still understand them or not, but that was another side of our life at home that, my grandmother would tell us, during our summer vacations, these lovely stories from the Ramayana. She would have the Ramayana with her, and she would actually, talk to us about the cause and effect, and about the relationships between why is something happening and all that. So, with all the cousins, it would be, listening to the Ramayana every day in the afternoon with the grandmother. As interesting was with our grandfather, he would make sure that we had these beautiful mangoes every day. So our day begins with mangoes, and we would get fresh from the market. And so he was also a very quiet person, but my brother tells me that he and my grandfather, they used to love to play chess a lot, actually. And so, but I would be running around, possibly climbing trees, plucking fruits, plucking vegetables. No one will believe I say I was a tomboy. Between all my cousins and brothers and all, so I think I was as comfortable with them. I was not a girly girly person, so I would not play with toys and dolls and all that. Interestingly, I would actually, stitch clothes for my cousin who would play with the toys. So my mother said, "No, you have to learn certain things." So, I started studying in a convent, a little later in my life, and there, and it was good that, they made you learn a little bit of cooking, a little bit of stitching and all. So that was my first experience. But then, my mother said, "You go and learn, professionally how to stitch clothes and all." So I did that, as a kid, and I would enjoy, the embroidery, actually. So I was absolutely, so my grandmother used to be apparently very good at embroidery. So we had a lot of her books, which were from France and from England. So you would know those times of the year, and go through those, trace them out, and stitch them in all sorts of different ways. So I mean, most of my clothes would have some embroidery or the other, when I was young, and they would be all a little I now I know you can say them that they are wacky, but in those days they were original pieces actually. Completely designed by me.
Clearly, you had such a lovely childhood, Deepti. And you know what? I'm seeing a very beautiful blend of art, literature, and science. And you have a grandmother who has needlework and the embroidery bit of it, a grandfather who makes sure that you have the best of nature, giving you the seasonal fruits, a mother who's into reading and very good literature, deep literature, and a father who's into science and evolved science. Oh my God, what all was going into your head, Deepthi? So clearly you were the topper in school and
No, I wasn't. I was an okay student. So what had happened was, as a kid, when my father was working my soul, so the school decided that I needed to get a double promotion. Okay, so I was always a little ahead of my classes, and possibly 1 year younger than most of my classmates, most times. So I was okay, but more importantly, with a father, who would teach you, things, I would go and solve the problems in one way, the teacher would teach in another way. So I had to go and explain after I got my marks sheet. Ma'am, this is not, this is also correct, ma'am. No, you gave me wrong, but it's okay. Then I would explain to her, but I know one Mrs. John was my maths teacher in school, and she was so kind, to let me explain to her, why I solved the problem in the way I solved it. So when my children were growing up, I would always tell them that whatever I teach you is just for you to understand, but solve the problem with the way the teachers would solve it for you rather than the way I would teach you, because then you would go through the same challenges that I would go through. So yeah. I was good in certain things. I was definitely good in math. The other thing that I would enjoy was actually quiz competitions and so on. So possibly I was the topper in my school for quiz. So crazy stuff, but
The inputs in your childhood made you so well-rounded. And today, when you look back, Deepti, this beautiful mix of literature, art, and science that had come so early in your life without you planning it, has it shaped you in the way you look at logic and reasoning as well?
I think more than that, it's given me a perspective of looking out, and seeing what's happening around me. I may not do a lot of analysis, but I definitely get, I know when I was young, I used to get really upset, if there was peace were plucked. I think I have these horror, this thing of going and fighting with the Air Force, saying that you can't break or cut my trees there. So I would do all those things, but I know it gave me an appreciation of, I don't want to say poverty, but taking care of people who were lesser privileged than me, actually. So I know one of the best moments in my life was, I had an auto driver since about 91, and then he had three daughters actually, and I helped them, in their education and so on. And then when the last one got married, he invited me, I went to meet them. All the three kids, all the three girls came. Ma'am, 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 how are you? And it was one of the loveliest moments that you can think of, when you see three girls who are grown up, who are, one of them had her own, shop, and another one was a teacher, third one was a housewife. But I mean, they were doing well for themselves, and it just gives you that goosebumps, I guess, that yeah, you are doing something worthwhile in your life, even if you take care of one person, So that is the thing, that you may not be able to change the world, and that's fine actually. I mean, that it took me a lot of time and effort to reconcile myself, saying that I can't change the world. I can't, but I'll do it one brick at a time, or one step at a time.
Yeah, so that's your choice. But let's go back to see what life had planned for you as a journey. So here was this girl, brilliant in maths and a few other subjects, great at extracurricular activities, quizzes especially, which is all about GK. How and where did you go post your high school?
So actually, it's, I mean, again, in an interesting thing, I decided that I would do engineering. I was very good at biology, actually, so both at dissections and all that. And but then I said, no, this is not for me, actually. So I was always better at math and physics, of course, at that reasoning and all that. So said I would do engineering, and possibly one of the very few girls who had taken up engineering in those days. So we were just two of us in our mechanical engineering course. 12 girls overall in that batch, actually. So that was something which I thought I would do.
But
And
why did you choose mechanical, Deepti?
again, because I was more a fixer doer, actually, rather than
Okay.
just a theoretician. So at home, when things blew, I would go and repair the fuses. When anything had to be done at home, I was possibly my mother's go-to person, actually, to help her out and all that. With a father as a scientist, there's only so much you can get done from him. So both of us were very independent, and she would encourage me to really do things myself,
Okay,
actually.
and mechanical, because you were a fixer doer, you thought that's what the engineering will teach about, or
And also
electronics, electrical.
I like the subjects, actually. So we had in our first year, so more than electrical and civil and all that. In those days, you wouldn't do civil as a girl,
Correct.
because you wouldn't be able to work in those unless you had a family business and all that. And electrical was, but I wasn't so, no, I don't think I related to those subjects as much as I related to the engineering, especially the design, machine design, drawing, all those, the workshops and so on. So, I mean, very strangely, so the workshop superintendents in the college would say, girls are very good at some of these. They do that fine work. So, I mean, you can imagine, now people say that there's so much of bias and all that. And here we had so much of encouragement, from our workshop superintendents. And I'm also very proud of the fact that, in engineering, when we had our final one of the exams and all that, possibly I was one of the highest scorers
Wow.
in machining, actually. So that's
Oh.
where the embroidery came in.
Yeah.
That
So clearly, you always took the road less traveled, and here you were a graduate of mechanical engineering. And what did you think you're going to do next? Did you have your
So,
road planned?
two things I think I was quite clear on that, I would want to join the Tata Group, actually. So, and I was really fascinated. I had the opportunity to go and see their power plant in Bombay, and just seeing, how differently it was managed, actually, with a lot of automation, with a lot of, multi-fuel, just a very different experience when you look at that. And then, you read so much about the group in the papers, and then the work that they were doing with telco and so on. So, like everyone says, Sudha Murthy had that experience. She went. I had a similar experience, actually, with the group. And yeah, I also went and fought back. But in the meantime, I got an offer from Tata Consultancy Services. So I said, I wanted to join the Tata Group. And I guess my father was more oriented for me to get into computers, because he felt that that was the latest and the greatest, that was happening at that time, in those times, actually. I did get into the group and said, that was one I wanted to do. Second thing is, I wanted to see what best I can do, at my work. So I may not mean be a CEO and on day one or whatever else, but I really was an aspirational thing that I really wanted to. A good leader, actually, so rather than just a manager. And that
And
also,
your
again,
entire childhood and engineering were in Bombay itself?
no, my childhood was, we were all over the southern cities, actually. So grew up in Mysore, grew up in Chidambaram, grew up in Chennai, in Madras in those days and all. And then in the 1971, so we had the experience of the India-Pakistan war in Bombay, and we moved to Bombay in 71. So since 71 till 84, so I was in Bombay, actually. So did my high school, middle school, high school, and engineering in Bombay. Yeah, joined TCS also in Bombay. Then, so Bombay also teaches you that, ability to be free, be comfortable traveling, and And you will never be idle in Bombay. You are encouraged to explore, do a lot of things and all that. So I was, I think, very, very busy, doing embroidery, music, all sorts of things, actually, on the weekends. And so my dad, he said, I need you to take a break, okay? Can you just go and sit in the balcony for half an hour? And I couldn't do
He clearly was teaching you
it.
mindfulness.
He was trying to get me to relax, actually. But for me, relaxation was always about reading, actually. So it was never anything else. But he felt that I shouldn't be doing anything else other than, like you said, mindfulness.
And I'm curious, Deepti, what is it that drew you to be so busy all the time?
I was doing so many different things, actually. So I was learning music, participating, seeing dance, seeing programs, and then and in Bombay you'd end up traveling so much, actually. So that
Correct.
also makes your day very long. But the weekends was always busy with these extracurricular activities. I was learning all sorts of artwork and so on. So, yeah, I mean,
Oh.
hobbies and hobbies and hobbies.
So you're a role model for today's child then.
I don't know about
Children
that.
don't have childhood, is what people see, that they are always busy. Parents are chauffeuring them from one class to another and another class. But the thing is, today's kids feel the strain. You seem to be very joyful doing all that you were doing. And clearly, another thing the city of Mumbai, that time Bombay, teaches is to value time.
Very
Because
much.
if you're like, for 8:42, train is at 8:42. If you come at 8:42 and a half, you miss
Your train is
the
gone.
train.
And that's something which I know I really value, my time. And I really get irritated when people don't value your time. So I don't appreciate that at all. So
Yes.
it's something which I
So
find
here
value.
is this young girl who can't sit still, who has to do something or the other, who's now a graduate in mechanical engineering with TCS on her profile. And what did you think you're going to do then on? Continue with TCS and move on? What was your plan at that point of time?
So my short-term goal was, that in India you could learn some things, but then, if you had to be a good professional from a technology perspective, then you had to go overseas, actually. So though I was married and all that, I said, look, I still want to go overseas. And you had to have that experience there, because the type of technology that you would get there and the access that you would have would definitely not be available in India. So that actually motivated me to travel. So I was in 86, one of the first women to go to this place in California. So I had the experience of working for a year and a half there, actually. And it gave me an opportunity to possibly round off myself, or start the whole thinking of who am I as a professional, actually. What is my work ethics like? What is my capability like, actually? And that was something which was very good from a personal development perspective, because I was also going and staying by myself, out in the US, and learning to be by yourself, for an extended period of time, whereas in India you were always surrounded by family,
And what were the answers, Deepti, for the question, who am I?
As my daughter says, Ramana Maharshi tried to ask that of himself. So who am I, or who I want to be, is be a good person, actually. So a good person could define myself, in a personal context, in a professional context. But whatever I can do, let me do the best of my abilities. And if I can do good things for people, let me do that. And if there is an opportunity for me to make a difference, I will do that. So these were some of the things that I felt. So when much later, and I was trying to read about ikigai and the purpose of your life and all that, then I got totally confused. I said, what is my purpose? And my purpose was never one thing. It was always all these many, many things and all that. So I said, let me do what I can you know, when I can, and when people ask me for help, I definitely, you know, extend that helping hand and, you know, be there for people. So that is something which
Okay.
I was
And
doing.
when you say this, right, when you're talking about this journey of being a mechanical engineer, two girls in the class, and you're one of the two, and then you move to California again, one of the first to do it. Looking back on all those journeys, what is it that motivated you, even though you didn't see people of your kind around, I'm saying gender-wise, around you? What is it that kept you going? What were you telling yourself, Deepti, at those points?
I think the interesting thing was I was always quite confident about myself. So I don't know what gave me that confidence, but you know, it never fazed me that, you know, there were no other women in the room, or you know, there were no other you know, people of my kind, you know, in a place and so on. So that was something which, you know, was, and yeah, it is there, it happens, but then do what you can do, actually. So yes, you know, you may not always get what you want, but you know, you can at least make a difference, is what I went by, actually. So yeah,
Yeah,
like
because
you said, you know, I've always wanted to change the world, but yeah, I change it one brick at a time, one day at a time, one minute at a time. Yeah.
that exercise your dad gave, asking you to go sit in the balcony doing nothing. In fact, today they say that itself is an art, where you go and sit in the balcony and you just think nothing. And because it's so difficult to do that in the world that we are today. So here you are. In the US, you completed, was that a master's degree that you went
No,
to?
I went for work, actually. I actually
Okay. Okay. And then after that experience, you were alone. So were there some reflections that you noted down or you can recall which started changing you as a person, or was life still the same?
So there were a few things which I felt I know I should do slightly differently. One was that I knew I didn't want to leave my family behind. I mean, when I went to the US, I had a 15-month-old daughter. My husband was taking care of her, and you know, I left her. I came back for a short while, but I didn't feel that, you know, it was right for me, and it was right for, I mean, my daughter didn't look at that time very disturbed, but you know, she keeps, you know, telling me that I ignored her for my profession. But that's okay. You know, you do what you do. So that was one decision that I had definitely taken, that I would not, you know, go out again and leave her behind, or leave the family behind, actually. The second thing that also gave me was, and I mean, this was a beautiful experience that I had there. No, in fact, one of the clients there said, "Dipti, we always thought you were a shrinking violet, actually. But then, you know, when you started working, interacting with us, we realized that there was nothing shrinking in you." So it also meant that you don't need to be, you know, very boisterous, very, you know, vocal, and you can still get your message across. And that was another one. The third one, as important for me, was the fact that I could be a really good professional, actually. So the work-wise, you know, the type of work that I could do, and you know, the type of problems that I could, you know, comprehend and to an extent solve them, and all that was something which was, I think, quite valued in the company also. You know, so for a long time they were always a little awe about, how did you manage to work with those tough clients? And how did you do such a tough role? So,
how
sorry.
did you, what did you do?
I did nothing, actually. I was just being patient, you know, heard them, then thought through, did the analysis, went back, shared with them, you know, my understanding, and I mean, it was just BAU for me. So it was quite not so, I didn't find anything really tough in that one. Yeah.
Yeah. So here I want to take you back to one of the points that you said about being vocal. In a world today where everybody is loud and tom-tomming about being present and being seen, how does that principle of yours work?
It works and doesn't work, actually. So in some cases, you know, I mean, it also depends on the environment that you're in, what your aspirations are and all that. You know, in certain professional spheres, I guess, you know, you would really need to be, you know, present, you need to be in the power circles, if you like, you know, actually being where, you know, the power is wielded. But as in, you know, important for me was also that, you know, I feel very strongly about certain things, actually, like, you know, environment and so on. So I said I would, you know, take that as one of my missions. So there were two things that I would do. One was on the environment, and I've been working with an NGO on that. And another one was, you know, encouraging, you know, women and encouraging people, you know, to, not just women, it's also men and kids around. So encourage them and help them out. So these were two things where I would not keep quiet. I would be a little bit more proactive and, you know, go out of my way to just give them a few pats on the back, so, which is what I guess every one of us want in our lives, actually.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
That's so true. And environment clearly was part of your growing up. And is that why logically you lean towards that as a cause as well that you'll speak about?
Yes. I mean, I always, and even when I was working and all, we would try and plant trees around. We would see, you know, the challenges about of growing, and, you know, people cutting them left, right, and center, and, you know, all that. And I mean, that was always a thing that I would observe. So I had one of my old colleagues from TCS, and so she had started her own NGO. She's been working on reforestation in the Wayanad and all that. So, and I had the opportunity to go and see, you know, the work that she's been doing, and it just gives me goosebumps, actually. I just love the impact that, you know, they have had, not just on the forest but also on the restorers and so on. So it just it's such a noble cause, you know. So yeah. And like, again, my daughter was saying, even if you don't plant a lakh trees, one tree will make a difference. And yes, I would love to get, you know, a lot of funding and all that, but yeah, you are limited by what you can, or what you get. So, but then, you know, see what difference you can make. And sometimes just being there, I don't understand their language, so they speak Malayalam, and I don't speak Malayalam, but they're just happy. Know that I'm there. I'm happy to be amongst themselves, see the work there. So for them, it's like they show me all the work that they've been doing there. This tree has grown. It's lovely that, you know, you see all that enthusiasm, that caring, you know, that you experience actually with them. So yeah, it just gives me.
Okay, and as for women and mentoring, okay, you said you mentor everyone, but women in particular, Deepti, because I'm sure you mentor a lot of them. When did you decide to transition? Was it a very natural progression that from your career you decided to be a mentor because you had the seniority? Was it something that you were pushed into, you volunteered into, or you started noticing differences in conversation?
So I had a very interesting experience, you know. So there was this executive leadership program that the Tatas ran, actually. And, you know, I mean, in a group of about 60, 80, there were just two women. So I said, look, you know, this is not going to work for women, you know, and if we really want to groom, and in those cases, I was being very partial, saying in TCS, if we wanted to grow our women, then we needed to do something, you know. So worked with the HR, you know, at that time, and then, you know, initially they came up with a program where it was more on personal branding and on grooming. You know, I said that's not going to work. So we need to help women understand strategy, help them to build the customer relationships, help them to understand what it takes to build high performing teams and all that. So we actually sat down, oriented the entire program. So it's a flagship program for women leadership development in TCS, and I'm really proud of the fact that I could shape it, and I was part of a lot of courses there, actually. So every time they asked, you know, they had the course, I would go and teach voluntarily, and that was one thing that I felt very strongly about. But, you know, I had a very, you know, interesting experience. One of these years, you know, we had these Women's Day celebrations and all that, and, you know, we had, as usual, a get together where all of us as women, we got together and all that. Then, you know, after the meeting was over, one of my colleagues, you know, he worked with me, say, Deepti, aren't you being very partial about this? You know, why are you doing this only to women? Even we want it. I was really touched. I felt that, yeah. And I know to an extent, you know, these programs that we have had in TCS for called IXL, and they are so women-oriented. So the men are really missing out because they don't have an equivalent, you know, of that nature and all that. But it is what it is. And so I've been trying to get them to have a little bit more balanced, you know. So let's do 30% men, 50, 70% women. But I don't know whether it has moved now or not. But that was where, so getting the Libran in me, you know, getting the more balanced world, you know, out there. So that was something which I felt strongly about. So I don't just do this for women, but yeah, anyone who reaches out to me, I mean, will get that helping hand.
But what is it about women that women, is it that women don't ask when they want something? Is that why, like the men who came and said, Deepti, we too want something like that? Have you seen women come forth and say, okay, can you do something for us on these lines? What is it about women that we still have people pushing women forward and we don't have women in the top rung of the leadership?
So I think a few things here. One is I have had women coming and asking me. So I mean, it's not that they don't ask. There are women who do this. In fact, when and I was telling someone, no, you didn't do this. So no, Deepti, I have done all these. I said, okay, fine. I'll give you the benefit of doubt. So I'm sorry, I didn't realize that. So but I've had quite a few women who come who used to come to me, challenge me, and tell me that, look, we too deserve this and so on. And that was something which was not, you know, it wasn't through any of these sessions that it happened, but it happened just because I guess we had a more open culture, and the culture was quite, you know, free flowing, if you like. And you know, there was no fear of failure, there was no fear of seniority or no that type of thing. So you can I would go and talk to the trainee on the ground actually, and so people would say, be careful, and I said, it's okay if they have the guts to talk to me, then you know, it's always good for them. This is how I got groomed. If I can help them, you know, it's a learning experience. But yeah, on a separate note, I've also seen a lot of women, you know, who back off from their careers actually, who say that no, you know, we need to, we don't want to work hard, we don't want to, you know, spend, you know, so much of time and effort. Just because you have done it, that doesn't mean that we will do it. Which is fine, it's their call finally, actually. But that's the other category. The third is there are also women who, you know, who do things, but you know, who are quiet about it. And but that's a very rare thing. I mean, at least in my own experiences at work, you know, I've not seen too many of those type of women who are, you know, quietly, you know, working in a corner and all. That doesn't happen as much, actually. I think women, you know, do bond, women do move around, and you know, there are a few cases where, you know, people possibly have not really been empathetic, you know. So I mean, I had a person who, in my team, so she had just come back after maternity, and she was on this evening call, and I really took that manager to task. I said, do you understand that she just come back from maternity? Are you being fair to her by giving her, you know, this? And does she need to be really at the office? Can't she go home and all that? And I mean, that was something which, no, it came not because there was this women's movement or women and this thing, but it just came naturally in terms of the. When the other interesting thing was that even in my own career, you know, so when I was in the family way, you know, my boss at that time said, Deepti, don't quit. I'll give you this room in this office. So if you once you have your baby, you can come, you can have the baby here with a nanny and all that, but don't quit. So that type of encouragement is something which I had. I mean, working from home, you know, when and it was unimaginable. So I would do that, and now you have all these policies. So but in those days, the policies were what we made of them actually. So I mean that, you know, it was very interesting for me. There was once a session, I think part of the Anita Borg, you know, this thing where I was speaking from TCS and another lady from IBM. And IBM, everything is very process oriented, everything is predefined. Whereas in TCS, if you see the need, you know, you would do it, and you wouldn't necessarily, not necessarily need to do it because there's a policy in place actually. And that's something which I strongly believe in. So I possibly do break a lot of policies, and processes, but I also I'm a person who wants to improve them and do better actually. So for me, it's status quo has never been the thing. It's always what can you do better actually, and that's possibly a good and a bad trait, because I'm never happy with status quo at especially at work or anywhere else. But it also gives me that opportunity to probe a lot more. So I used to have this wonderful client in the UK, and the group CEO, he and I, we would have some very interesting conversations. And at that time, my boss Chandra, he would come, and we would have these quarterlies and all that stuff. So our relationship was a little bit beyond just work actually, and so we would discuss. So he would always ask me about what's happening with our competitors, what's happening in the marketplace, how do you see technology evolving, and all that. And it's a phenomenal opportunity for you to have those type of conversations. As interesting for me was, when he was talking of, he's also possibly one of those leading lights in the British this thing. So he was asking me about this, should countries have these mandatory places on the board and things like that. That happens. And I was telling him that, look, in many countries you need it, because at that time India didn't even have posh actually, so we would only have fight cases using one of those precedents and all that. And when countries don't have it, then these seats on the board are what will actually bring about the change. But then when countries are evolved, possibly yes. And I would say at that time, there were very few countries in the world other than the Nordics, so where things were not moving very well for the women in senior levels and all that. So that was one, so having those type of conversations and debating that. As interesting for me was, another client of mine said, look, one of my colleagues, she's starting off, so we are the cities, what it is called in the UK. And then just be around for her actually, talk to her. I said, sure, anytime. And also I just met with her and so on. But it was good, to interact with, women, not just in India, but so. And my boss would pull my leg and say, Deepti, all the toughest women are your clients. I said, did you get them to be my clients because they were tough and women, or what was?
Globally, what was that common thread that ran through women? It didn't matter which country, but globally, what was the common thread that ran through women that
Sure,
was?
hard work. And you would be amazed. Actually, in fact, one of my clients, she was my client way back in the 2003, 4, and all. I'm still in touch. But the way she keeps herself professionally updated, I mean, it's just an inspiration for me even now. So she was quite senior to me at that time itself, and even at this age, the way she continuously upgrades her knowledge. I mean, I've seen many of them doing that actually. That is one common thread that you see. The other is a very deep sense of values actually, whether it in ironically or interesting, it was always the family values that were there, that were very strong, every one of us. As interesting was also a sense of wanting to give back to society. That was another very strong value system that you would see actually. And also a very strong work ethic actually, that do the best that you can. I mean, I'm not, I mean, when I say this, I'm saying it because I've tried to follow it as much as I could. But and I've seen many other, they are successful in their own ways. They may not always be, CEOs, board members, whatever else. They may not be by designation, but they are people who have been there, done that, who have done their best that they could, in whatever way they could do it, actually. So yeah, so I've seen this across any geography that you talk of. So actually, so inequality can come in any form, shape, or size, actually, and. No, you can't say that you've dealt with it all. It will never happen, and there will be always some opportunity for you
That's true. That's true.
to make a difference. So look for that if you can. So,
Yeah,
thank
very beautifully said. So, if there is a young girl who's just starting out,
you.
what is it that Deepti would tell her to remember in this journey that she's setting out for herself?
I would just tell her that do your best every day. I mean, don't take that. I mean, today's day that I'm going to slack off or I'm going to relax and all. You set aside. You have time for work. When you're playing, play well, play hard. I mean, when you're working, work hard. But don't look at doing something in between. Actually, don't be lazy about your work. When you want to be lazy, be lazy. If you want to take time off, for relaxing and all that, do that. But when you're at work, I mean, like you said, mindfulness. So be mindful of the fact that you are at work and do the best that you can. Nothing more is expected of you. So just be that.
You have gone through so many challenges yourself. You have moved away from family, come back to them. You've been a lone woman in many places, or the smaller minority in places, especially with the way you chose your subject in college with something like mechanical engineering. So, when you have always been in the minority, and today when you enter boardrooms, women are in the minority. What is it that we need to understand, both men and women, to have a level playing field? Is it a dream or is it possible?
I think the biggest challenge that most of us face, whether it's men or women, is the whole ability to listen, actually. I mean, and this is something which I feel strongly about. Listen to the small voices, actually. So there may be some people who are not very confident in what they are saying, but then they possibly have a viewpoint. Isn't it your responsibility as a leader to listen to them, to understand their viewpoint, and possibly if you think it is worthwhile, then do something about it. But that listening and that willingness to be open to new ideas and that willingness to be challenged, I think these are some things that all of us face, whether it is as men or women, actually. So I think that is something which possibly is the biggest challenge that we all of us have, and we need to see what we can do about it.
And
Yeah.
according to you, who is a good listener?
I don't think there's, I mean, anyone is a good listener or a bad listener. You possibly need to decide that you will listen, actually. I mean, I had a very interesting experience. My daughter has her own startup, and she didn't want me to, or she didn't want to interact with me on her work for a long time, actually. And then one fine day she was really saying, "Mama, it's not going anywhere," and all. I said, "Don't cry. If you're crying, then you let me help you out." And I said, "What will you do?" I said, "Whatever work you do, I'll help you in that. Actually, I don't need to do anything more. But I don't want you crying. I don't want you to feel." So, and she said, "Well, sometimes I just want to vent. Actually, I don't want you to give me a suggestion or a solution." So now I have to be mindful about saying, "Okay, now I ask her, is this a venting session or is this a..." So, but yeah, I guess all of us need to have that venting
Yeah.
thing. But yeah, it's
It's such
responsibility.
a beautiful example, because when you take that role of the mentor and you're wearing that cape of a mentor, you feel everyone who comes to you comes for advice. And it's a very natural tendency.
Yes.
Sometimes they just come to use you as a sounding board. And yeah, this is so beautiful. Now, as far as NGOs go, Deepti, I know you're actively involved in NGOs as well. When did that journey begin, and what all are you doing in that space?
So, I mean, it was interesting because there is this organization called Swami Vivekananda Youth Movement, actually, and one of the founder members, I mean, one fine day he came to our office, along with one of our colleagues. One of our colleagues, he's really passionate about, giving back to society and all that. And so he said, "Deepti, this person is there. His name is R. Balu, actually. So he's now part of the capacity building mission, all sorts of things, actually." And he said, "Balu is here. Are you okay to meet?" I said, "Fine, I'm okay to meet." And then met with him. Then he would come every year, and once he came with someone else from Cornell and all that. So it was an interesting interaction for me. Then I went and saw what SVYM were doing in Mysore, near Mysore, actually, and had that opportunity and all that. So for me, the formal no, NGO that I really saw was SBMIM. As interesting for me also was the fact that in TCS, we had something else called Maitri actually. And that was a movement which was started by Mrs. Ramdhare. So Mr. Ramdhare was the CEO at that time, and his wife, she said that, look, when many families go overseas, when people go out of the country, they always struggle with like loneliness, with not knowing what to do and so on. So can we reach a helping hand out to them, help them to integrate better in the parts of the world that they are in actually? And that is something which all of us have experienced. We have experienced the fact where we go to these cold countries, you don't see daylight for days together and so on. But then I thought Maitri was a beautiful thing. But the interesting thing was Maitri also encouraged people to explore themselves, and do what they can back to the society, whether it was in teaching or any other. Like I was telling you about my experiences with planting trees and all that. So we tried to do this in the Whitefield area, and we would plant trees, and once the trees grow, then they would be cut. And then it was always a fight to see whether we can actually grow the trees there. Then, but that was something which again happened. So Maitri happened in the company, and people were going and talking to NGOs. So for me, what was really, what really inspired me was I met with not Balu but someone else called M.A. Balasubramanian, and he was talking of the work that they were doing with the Jain Kurbas, Kadu Kurbas, and I mean you hear of all these communities through your children's social studies and all that these are all the communities of India, but then they were all displaced when the KRS dam was built, and that they were all struggling. They had a lot of different challenges and all that. And then this organization was trying to help them from a healthcare perspective, from education perspective. So I had the opportunity to go and see the tribal school and so on. And they said, no, we have dreams of making this a huge one of 750 students that we would accommodate and all that. I said, then what about the food and how are you ensuring that they get? So we said, we were trying to do this. They had one person who was helping them out. I said, I will fund for you employment of these gardeners actually. So a couple of them. And but that whole fund should be used only for growing food, nothing else. Okay, so it was my this thing of I always thank the goddess Annapurneshwari. So saying that, look, when if you can give the children the healthiest possible beginnings in their lives, that's the best that you can do for them actually. So I've been working with SBYM now, so I support them. I've been supporting them for a long time now, but they also talk to me, and just like I said, I'm just not even a sounding board, I'm just a listening board there. So but it's good actually. So that, and then Balu asked me if I would be part of the one of the organizations that they have, which is grassroots research and advocacy movement. So I was working, so once I retired, then I said, fine, I will do it. So I'm also there. The mandate is a little different. It is looking at public policy, implementation plans for public policy, and then seeing how you can either bridge the gap or improve on it and so on. So I don't know if I'm contributing anything there, but it just gives you that perspective that you're not just being idle. And all of us crib about saying that the government doesn't have adequate policies and all that. Here's an organization which is trying to do its little best. So in whatever way I can, I will do that. And in the meantime, like I mentioned, Meera, who was working with me at TCS, she quit her job, and then she started this Forest First. So then she would keep calling me up and tell me what she's been doing. And I would, like I said, I just would say, very good, excellent, keep it up, let me know if you need any help, so on and so forth. So that's the, then, we had some funds from one of the Tata companies, and I think I got more thrill of getting that funding to her, to Meera, than possibly I would have got with my $1 billion contract that I won or something like that. I was jumping up and down all over the place. Yay, we have got this. Everyone at home would have thought, oh, what a crazy mom she we have. So, but it just gives you that I don't know whether it's grounding or that sense of satisfaction that you are doing what you can actually, and what is within possibly your abilities, and seeing how you can help the world at large actually. So, but yeah, been working with NGOs. They come ask me for help. I listen to them. Some of them, the relationship extends a little bit more. Some of it. Just a one-off, it's fine. That's what it is actually. So,
So, do you now go and sit in your balcony and spend time with yourself, which your dad insisted years ago?
I
What do
spend
you
time in
do?
the balcony reading actually. Yes.
And what do you do as a pastime when you don't feel like reading, when you just want to relax? What do you do?
I mean, like I said, and you know this too. So for me, it's music, listening, reading, and I don't know. I started watching a series of different languages and all that. So I've always been good at picking up languages. So I've never seen a serial all my life until I retired. So I'd never watched TV for more than like 15 minutes possibly or something like that. So I remember as a child I've watched the Swan Lake and all that, the Bolshoi Theatre. But beyond that, I don't remember if I've really seen too much of TV and some of the old Hindi movies and things like that. But I said, no, I'm going to learn, to recognize different languages. I'm trying now, so.
No, but actually, that's really a very good way to pick up language. You know, Chitrahar, when Doordarshan used to have Chitrahar, they used to have the karaoke style where the lyrics would come as the song goes. Many people picked up Hindi because of that, how to read Hindi because of that. And when they realized it's actually working, that's how they continued. And a lot of those was implemented in many other things of having subtitles.
Subtitles,
Yeah, when Doordarshan first brought in Hindi as a subtitle for the songs, you know, so we could sing while watching the TV. That was very novel at that time, but that because you remember or you by heart the lyrics, right? But you don't know how it's written and you're weak in Hindi, it was a very easy way to build it. And I think what you're doing is right. Deepti, you've led a very beautiful, momentous life. And there are so many things which are so beautifully tied together into a pattern when I'm listening to you and seeing how every little thing that happened as a kid has had an influence in who you are today in finding joy in everything that you're doing. Okay, it's not about like you lived every moment as a child. And that's exactly what you're doing even now, living every moment, making a difference to people around you, and very clearly walking the talk of it. You don't have to influence a billion, even if it is one person at a time, that's good enough. And in such a beautiful life, are there some highlights or some wonderful moments that you just sit, reflect, and smile about?
I've been fortunate that I've had many of those. So, just like I was telling you about, the interactions that I have with my daughter. I mean, just today morning, I was talking to my son and saying, and I had gone to Hyderabad. Unfortunately, he was changing house, so I was with my brother-in-law. And then, we were talking. I said, I think he really enjoyed having me. My brother-in-law enjoyed having me with him, for a few days. And he gave him. Said, yeah, I missed all that. I mean, it feels so good, that your son of 30 years is still wanting to spend time with you. And these are small moments, but I think they are the rich. They are what makes my life rich, actually. So, like my daughter saying, is this a venting time or is this a brainstorming time or is this? So I just love those. And then with my grandson, where he tells me about us. So is Nani coming? Is she going to be there for my? And they're saying, Nani, aap mat jao, aap yahi rako. I mean, it makes you feel good, that yeah. The family wants you there. They feel that. And so my daughter's mother-in-law is saying, "Aap nahi aaye bahut din se, aapko miss kar rahe the hum log." So I said, "Okay, you've lived a worthwhile life when you know that, notwithstanding anything else, that the family bonds are still there and they're so strong actually." So I think that's what makes it all worthwhile for me actually. So yeah, there will be highs and lows. There will be times when that bond may not be there, or that may not be as good as it, you know, you want it to be, but it's okay. It's part of my learning and everyone else's learning.
Yeah, that's so true. And you know, one of the recent events that made all of us realize the value of these family bonds was the pandemic. So
Absolutely.
all of us have taken reflections from the pandemic, but well, I don't know how many of us still remember the lessons, but what have your reflections from the pandemic been, Dipti?
I think see, until the pandemic, I was literally on the road. I was traveling every week, you know, every second week, and when it was just incredible how busy I was actually. So suddenly this happened, and then you know you're at home 24/7, you know, you have a very small, family too, you know, and you know there's beyond a point in time, you know, where you say. You will not impinge on each other's times, and then you will give each other the space. Actually, giving each other a space in a small house is not possible. So not so easy actually. But then making a conscious effort to do that, I think that was a good reflection for me. As important, I think it was also a good. So when I felt sick a couple of times, then. My son looked after me, and my daughter was so taken aback. She said, "I can't believe that this guy is doing this to you." So she was a little worried that, you know, who will take care of mama? So for her, it was always that, you know, she thought that she would be the only caregiver at home and all that. But then she was quite pleasantly and surprised and happy that, you know, her younger brother also was doing that. And that whole bonding, you know, I mean, for me, and you know, learning to cook, you know, all sorts of different dishes and all that. So I'm not a very good cook. I'm not too fond of cooking myself, so I would do it because I had to do it. So learning to cook new things, making a difference to the family and all that. So my son would always say, "Amari, we know when you're making the food versus, you know, the cook makes it." I said, "Okay, but give me a break. I can't do this." But then you had to do it. So then that whole division of labor, you know, what would you do versus what the family would do and all that. So a lot of different, and all of us becoming more responsible for each other, for ourselves actually, and taking care of ourselves. I think the one thing that pandemic taught me was also to go back and, you know, start doing yoga regularly and, you know, taking care of my health and so on. So which I would never bother otherwise actually. So yeah. And these were some of my lessons, you know, my takeaways.
And we are at that point of the conversation where we'll be talking three life lessons that you'd like to leave us with, because you've had such a beautiful life. You've made a difference in so many places. You've broken so many different rules that were set, and you made an impact wherever you have been. So, three life lessons, Deepti, that you'd like to leave us with.
Well, I would say, as a person, do the best that you can in every situation that you are in. You know, so try and not be wishy-washy. Try and not do things by half measures. That's my one life lesson, actually. Saying, you know, if I'm in this conversation, I'm in this conversation, and nothing else will, you know, impact it. And if I'm at work, it's the work. If I'm with family, it's family. And there's no two ways about it. That is one, you know, important thing for me. The second is, you know, as in important is, you know, being, you know, aware of your surroundings, being aware of, you know, who you are with, you know, what are they doing, and, you know, seeing how it makes it a little bit more holistic, if you like, rather than just a one-dimensional one. And third one is as important is identify what your purpose is in life is. You know, it may not be just one. It just could be many, and it depends on the situation. But then, look for that, and that will come on it will be so visible to you, actually. So,
Yeah.
yeah.
Wow, this is so beautiful. Deepti Vidya, it was like pleasure talking to you. Thank you so much for sharing your beautiful life and the difference you're still making in the people who are connected to you and who you want to bring a difference in. Stay blessed and continue inspiring. An honor having had you on You and I with Rashmi Shetty.
Thank you, Rashmi. It was lovely talking to you, and I just love the way the conversation flew. You just led it beautifully. So thank you again.
Thanks so much.
With that, we complete this episode of You and I with Rashmi Shetty. Do let us know if you know inspirational people whose story needs to be heard. You can write in at rashmi.thethirdeye@gmail.com. That is rashmi.thethirdeye@gmail.com.